Bunce Watson. Despite being a woman in the 1770s, Hannah Bunce Watson defied traditional norms by undertaking a leadership role in business as the publisher of the Connecticut Current, facing adversity with resourcefulness, and aiding her country's quest for liberty during the Revolutionary War. Good day, Mattel executives and creative team. As you know, we have just launched our new line of Barbie dolls, the Inspired Woman and She-Ro series, honoring women from the past and the present. Out of 8,000 moms surveyed, 86% are concerned about the type of role models their kids are looking up to. According to Mattel spokeswoman, Marissa Beck, the Inspiring Women series will grow beyond the three dolls it has so far, and the Inspiring Women series pays tribute to incredible heroines of their time who took risks, changed rules, and paved the way for generations of girls to dream bigger than ever before. Many are familiar with the story of Frida Kahlo, Katherine Johnson, Amelia Earhart, but there are still many females who need to be celebrated as hashtag more role models. I'm here today to pitch to you a new inspirational woman to be considered the next doll. Picture this, a Hannah Bunce Watson doll. What? You are not familiar with the story of Hannah Bunce Watson? Well, through miraculous wrinkle of time, I am able to present to you, here today, as she's known throughout the Hartford Current family, Miss Hannah B. It's 1777. I'm 27 years old. My husband is Ebenezer Watson, the publisher of the Connecticut Current and Weekly Intelligencer, a popular newspaper throughout the colonies. Whereas most newspapers have around 600 subscribers, the Current has 8,000, ranging from New Hampshire to Delaware. I spend my days performing duties of good colonial wife, but a war is percolating and the rebels need to know what is going on in the world. Many of New York's papers were only pro-British, and Boston's Patriot papers had been shut down by the British. The Connecticut Current was the only paper that was big enough to send out reliable information to all colonies. Then, disaster struck, one of many to come. My husband, Ebenezer, was consumed with smallpox and died suddenly. I was grieving, looking after five kids under the age of seven and living at a time where very few women owned business or land, and most women lived their lives subservient to men. However, the concept of independence hinged on providing priceless communication about the war. So, I mustered up as much courage as I had in me and took on the job I had inherited. Perhaps I did this because I wanted to support my family, or maybe I had a hidden passion for writing, or maybe I thought I could be the next Shakespeare. I started working at the Current and its company business, the paper mill, which I co-owned with a widow named Sarah Ledyard. My first published piece was my husband's obituary. On Tuesday last departed this life after a distressing sickness, Mr. Ebenezer Watson, printer, in the 34th year of his age. A gentleman of the most humane heart, susceptible for the tenderest feelings for distress, in whatever manner discovered. Jealous of the rights of human nature and anxious for the safety of his country, his press hath been devoted to the vindication of rational liberty. The governor's company of cadets, of which he was an ensign, in token of respect for the deceased, attended his funeral in the uniforms. He has left a melancholy widow and five young children and a numerous circle of friends to lament his death. In my dual role, I balanced motherhood and the business. If I wasn't changing nappies, I would be writing and choosing articles to publish in the paper. Then I had to be cooking dinner and kept collecting over $3,800 worth of remaining debt from subscribers who owed Ebenezer money. Then I had to be cleaning the house and overseeing typesetting. Typesetting took an average of 25 hours a week to prepare for each edition. Then I had to be tending to the garden and selling subscriptions to people all throughout the colonies. Despite my noble intentions, I recognized I needed help. I turned to George Goodwin, who had previous experience working at the Current. We struck up a partnership compromise. He would run the production end, and I would run the business end. We published Under the Masthead, containing the freshest advices, both foreign and domestic, printed and published by Watson and Goodwin. Just when things were finally starting to look up, more disaster struck. The paper mill, which I co-owned with Sarah Ledyard, was suspectedly burned to the ground by Tory supporters in an effort to destroy Patriot communication. Lots of Ebenezer's debts were still unpaid, therefore there was no money to rebuild the mill or buy paper. Seeing no way out, George and I planned for a last issue. This was not just a crisis for me, but for the Patriot cause as well. Without it, there was no reliable way to spread widespread news throughout people all throughout the colonies. In fact, David Ramsey, Continental Congress delegate, reflected that, quote, in establishing American independence, the pen and the press had merit equal to that of the sword. We couldn't give up. Sarah Ledyard and I petitioned to the Connecticut General Assembly, and within hours they responded. Thanks to their brilliant mind, we were able to come to a compromise. They would hold a statewide lottery, 6,000 tickets for $6 each. $31,000 would go to the winners, and $5,000 to rebuild the mill. Even though we had to print on wrapping paper sometimes with no masthead at the top, the Connecticut Current never missed an issue, even to this day. It is my greatest legacy. The story continues. Under Hannah's leadership, the Current continued to keep readers updated about the war. She included letters from the Battle of Monmouth and a long, detailed account, all written by George Washington himself. Ultimately, Hannah married her neighbor Barzilai Hudson, and by law, she had to give all of her possessions to him, including the Current. And one of her sons, Henry Hudson, grew up to be mayor of Hartford. In 1837, the Connecticut Current became the daily Hartford Current and remains the oldest continuously published newspaper in America. Hannah Bunce Watson Hudson died of the flu at age 57, without much fanfare. A one-sentence obituary marks her death in the Current, never mentioning her contribution. Her grave lies in a filthy trash cemetery in Hartford, and her gravestone is so chipped her name is barely legible. Marty Petty, the Current's only other woman publisher, says, quote, Hannah was the matriarch of the Hartford Current. She deserves to remember for what she did to the paper running after the fire, but also for being a strong woman. We don't know a lot about her, but some things are clear, like the fact she was a risk taker and someone willing to push on through adversity and find a way to get things done. Hannah's spirit continues to embody the Current. Did you know that Hannah was one of 37 people inducted into the Connecticut Women's Hall of Fame? Or that she is one of the first people inducted in the Connecticut Journalism Hall of Fame? Hannah paved the way for females to believe they can do whatever they set their mind to. This is the perfect role model and will be an excellent addition to Mattel's Inspiring Women series. Hannah was a risk taker who was unafraid to ask for help. She showed perseverance, resilience, passion, grit, and, to quote historian and author Cynthia Wolfe Boynton, Hannah was truly remarkable. A revolutionary woman in a revolutionary time. Thank you.